Welcome back to the Tuesday Weekend. Today we are talking about the pandemic. And I would like to start this segment by talking about an economics issue that is not particular just to the restaurant industry, but in fact reaches into all facets of late-stage capitalism. And that is basically the adversarial conflict between profits and product. So owners, and here I have a huge caveat, I'm really especially talking about corporate owners here. I love independent restaurants and bars and coffee shops. I have lots of friends who are small business owners, and I am mostly talking about the billionaire class. I don't believe billionaires should be a thing, as they are demonstrably harmful to our society. So when I say owners, I'm talking more about them than about you. But owners in general have an expectation of a return on their investment. And when the profit coming back to them is less than they expect, there are really three ways of adjusting that. You can raise your prices, you can lower your cost of goods, or you can pay people less to do it. So places are reluctant to raise prices for fear that they will be undersold by the competitors and eventually run out of business. And the restaurants, especially whose main clientele are seniors on fixed income, raising menu prices really can have a profound negative impact on just who is coming through your door. So the staff. Unlike manufacturing, restaurant work is not very easily shipped overseas, so there really isn't the option of offshoring jobs to a less expensive economy. But, all right, so maybe you can get rid of a few of your more expensive employees and then spread their work around among the rest of the staff. Everyone will love that. That'll keep everyone happy, yeah.
A lot of restaurants went to the Darden model. That's one of the big billionaire restaurant groups where all of a sudden we're tipping out everybody.
We will get to tip outs, yes.
Yeah. Yeah, they took money away and just spread it around. Our money, though, not even theirs.
Your money, exactly. Yeah. And there's
they didn't pay down for this. We did.
All right, so then there's the cost of goods. So you could play the smaller portion, but of course, everyone's going to notice that. Or maybe instead of the prime cut, you go to the cheaper select option, which, again, some people are going to notice that. Or instead of using the bakery in town for your burger buns, you could go to the food distributor's value brand. Or in the ultimate insult to both your food quality and your customers, you can change from the very costly butter to the much cheaper margarine, and you lose me as a customer right there. But
no, thank you.
So all this staff reduction and cost cutting leads to both a more stressed crew, but then ultimately a worse end product. That plate is not as good as it used to be, all in the name of profits, which of course then leads us to people who live solely on passive income telling the rest of us loudly about how nobody wants to work anymore. All right. I mean, my next question I was going to ask is, do you want to work anymore? And both of you kind of covered that in the last segment.
For me, it was good. The money on unemployment was good, but it wasn't what I made. Mm-hmm. The only caveat I had on that was like, yeah, I'm getting basically it was about $1,100 a week on unemployment is what I was making. Mm-hmm. And I saved a ton of money because nothing was open.
Yeah.
I mean, I like to do stuff. We couldn't sail because sailing was only families only for like a year. Unless you were immediate family, you couldn't be on the same boat with someone. Wow. Couldn't do that unless I took a boat out by myself. Bars and restaurants were closed. I'm not a big online shopper. I'm like, go buy food and go support my friends who are doing pop-up bars where you could stop in once a week and buy a drink with everyone with masks on and take them home, which mm-hmm. was actually a lot of fun to see my friends during COVID because I didn't get to see any of my people I see at all my bars and restaurants who we've known each other for years.
I think for me, I ended up making, with the hourly job, I was making a little bit more on unemployment, but it was part-time. So when I started going back to work, I was still able to collect partial unemployment, which was great, but it wasn't necessarily a job that had any upward mobility. It was something that I was just sort of doing to get by. And for me, I'm very much an introverted person. I wasn't going out to begin with. So my entire social network collapsed because my friends are the people who I work with. But at the same time, once I did go back and once I did get back into the kind of supervisory position, it was very different what work we could get out of people as well. We had people who were not willing to work the same kind of
entitlement.
Yeah, that's it. It's a lot of entitlement. New York City had, at the time, a minimum wage of $15. The company that I was at was paying $18 as COVID pay. It had been at $16 before. And if people weren't getting that, they weren't willing to work. and people weren't willing to work for $18 an hour to do the same really entry-level tasks that they were perfectly willing to do for $16 an hour before the pandemic hit. There was so much entitlement and so much, well, you're not paying me enough to do this. And they're not wrong, because they're making just enough to survive in a very expensive city, while the owners are, during regular times, are, you know, jet setting off and again making that passive income, occasionally like doing the FaceTime, making sure that they're being seen in their outlets, being seen by their team. But what else are you doing? And I know as a manager, some of those things are really kind of hard to see, that you're dealing with permits and advertising and kind of keeping on top of the rest of the team, working with your directors and your managers to make sure that things are moving smoothly. But that doesn't take a full 8-hour day for many days. And so you are really getting that like passive income. And so that was really interesting. And then there were people I worked with that truly just did not want to work. If it was anything outside of the job description, nope, I'm not doing it. And that was something I hadn't experienced before, where it's like part of the job description on so many job descriptions for positions that I supervise is the last point is, and anything as asked of you by management, right, within the bounds.
Within reason.
I might ask you to clean the toilets and that's not in your job description, but we are a restaurant that does not have dishwashers. Somebody's got to do it. One of the things I say in orientation when we talk about how we're going to distribute tasks is some nights it's your turn to clean the bathrooms and some nights it's my turn to clean the bathrooms. And I will absolutely do it because I think it's really important. I'm working with high school and college kids in their first positions. I want them to see that they have managers going above and beyond, and part of my job is also part of their job. That's the manager that I wanted when I was that age, and I think it's important to be that model. But the not wanting to work is, you're not paying enough for the actual work you're asking me to do to be able to live and have a life. Right. But right, you are sitting in an office making, you know,
whatever,
many thousands of dollars in salary, having your health insurance covered as an owner, and not thinking, oh, maybe my team needs health insurance in the middle of a pandemic, and maybe that's something I should be investing in.
Sure.
That's how you're going to keep people.
Yeah, absolutely. And
there was absolutely no outreach to actually do anything to keep anyone.
Yes, so right, much, Nick, that like there was not that outreach. It's like, well, I will stay in my house so that I don't cross-contaminate with you. And I'm like, put on a mask and get down here.
Yeah,
those owners should have been like the first person on the floor actually doing the work. And for the one organization that I was part of, I was not seeing that. They were hiding in an office doing everything they could to stay out of the building.
Our managers were there. I mean, I had one really good, the last restaurant, the general manager is fantastic. He's still there. He's a great guy. He does a tremendous job. When I left that last year, we were on our third management team except for him. Since COVID. Wow. They made one of our hostesses a salaried manager, and she was not a good hostess. Oof. And then they put her in charge of scheduling. So yeah, half the staff kind of left. They also still have that animosity towards her as being a horrible hostess for years.
Yeah.
And she was like a vindictive person and stuff. I literally had a day where I'm like, why am I scheduled Tuesday days? I don't work days. It says in my availability, I don't work days. And she's like, oh, your availability says you do work days. Look, the general manager was there too. And I'm like, okay. So we pull it up and I scroll down and I'm like, well, that was changed the day you put the schedule out by you, because it's logged in there. Yeah. And she's like, oh, and I'm like, yeah, I'm not going to be there Tuesday day.
Yeah.
And that was kind of for me. I was like, writing's on the wall. I need to grab another job. At the time, that's something else that we might get to just briefly, but everybody's hiring.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was another thing.
If you're good at all, that's when they're like, hey, we'll give you $19 an hour to bartend. You know, we'll just come in. Please work.
Right.
Like if they get someone who could walk in and actually knew how to make cocktails and could talk to guests, that's your interview. It's like, you know, make me an old fashioned here. You're hired.
It's funny because I've had a recent conversation with a very close friend who is not happy in her current position as a sous chef. And my response is, you're a sous chef. Go anywhere. Like there are plenty of restaurants where she could walk in the door and just say, look at me. I am the chef now. And that's it. She's the chef now. You know, like that, she will be better than whatever they've got. That's a tangent.
In places are still having problems hiring. Like our place.
Oh, absolutely.
It's like, we need another bartender. I know why they can't hire another bartender, because we've got a chef trying to hire bartenders. He just doesn't know.
Baseball.
I'm just like, dude, we work at a hotel. hey, we need you to work one night a week and cover some shifts. If you work one day a week, you get hotel benefits. You can stay at any of this hotel in the world for 80% off. Every bartender I talk to is like, dude, I'll work one day a week there. And I tell them that I'm like, I'll bring them in. And they're like, we have to do this, this, this. I'm like, dude, just talk to them first and talk them into the job. They're not going to do all the fill out stuff and all the paperwork and everything to then come in and hear you blather on about whatever idea you have for the future. They don't care. We don't care. Just put us behind a bar, liquor behind us, people in front of us. That's all we want.
All right. Let's get back to what Nick had touched on. And that is the tip out and really getting the difference between getting paid by the house and getting paid by the guests, which for a long time leading up to the pandemic really was skewed in favor of the front of house. And I only say this as somebody who lived through it in the kitchen. The restaurant that I did my internship at during culinary school, I was making crap.
Yeah.
I think $10.50 an hour. And one of the servers was sitting at the bar after work one night. She really only worked 4 days a week, 9 months out of the year, and complaining that she had only made $52,000 that year, which was like twice what I made working my ass off in the kitchen.
Yeah.
And just didn't want to hear it. But at the same time, part of the problem there is we need to pay the kitchen more, and it shouldn't come at the sacrifice of the front of house folk. Now, sure, if you're a server and you are tipping out standardly your bartender at a minimum, probably a busser, maybe a food runner.
That should be about it.
In a busier restaurant, perhaps multiple of them. And generally, most places, the tip out is based either on your total sales or on your total tip taken in yourself. It kind of varies from house to house. And some places do both
and give you the option, you know.
Yeah.
Like I worked in a bar where the cocktail tip out was either like 4% of their total tips or 10% of their liquor sales.
Sure.
If you were a service bar.
That makes sense.
The restaurant I was at first was just tip out the bar, tip out the food runner, tip out the bussers.
Yep.
So I didn't have to tip out the bar as a bartender, which was great. But, you know, that was a pretty standard.
Yeah.
After COVID, we're tipping out the kitchen and the dishwashers, which they combined, which I thought was kind of bullshit. And we were tipping out the hosts, which is something you should never, ever, ever do.
Yeah,
we had people paying hosts for more tables and stuff. I mean, I'm just watching. One of the best restaurants I worked at, the lead host in the restaurant, there was like two of them. It was in Salt Lake. So there was a public side and then a private side. The morning hostess and the lead hostess and the one side were both salaried. They didn't get an hourly. They were making a salary. And if someone walked up, hey, I'll give you $20 for another table, they would literally just go tell the manager, hey, this guy offered me $20 for more tables. And you'd be fired immediately. Same thing in the oyster bar. The lead host was salaried. They understood. They paid you for what you did. They paid the kitchen well. People wanted to work for that company because they paid well. And it was a good job. And it was solid. And it was structured. You still had all the fun shenanigans you have in a restaurant and all that. And they understood that, like, you know, safety meetings and such.
Yeah.
But you got paid. I mean, I was there for 6 years. And there was some turnover in the kitchen. And half the time the turnover in the kitchen was if someone moved or if they sent someone to culinary school. While I was there, they sent three different cooks to culinary school while I was working there that they paid for.
That's cool.
That's really awesome.
It was a great work group to be with and stuff. I mean, at the time, it doesn't exist anymore. But still, that's what I mean. And the tip outs were straight up. No one had a problem with the tip out. Everybody made money. Being front of the house, which is different from what a lot of what you guys did, what your server friend was complaining about, and this is what's going on right now, is tip outs up around 40% to 50%.
Sure.
Yeah.
I mean, you're still making money in the front of the house, of course, and you're doing better than the back of the house, but it is really tough to look at that and like, I made this much to start the day. I've got an app on my phone for my last job where I can pull up what I made that day and then all the tip out and what I ended up with.
And I think there is a difference in mindset from the owners who come to the conclusion of, hey, the cooks need to take home more. We can't keep cooks if we only pay them this amount, so we need to be able to increase their pay. There's a difference between then, okay, well, then I'm going to put a 3% surcharge on the check, just kind of a line item, just like your tax. And then the customers are paying for it. It never passes through the front of house hands.
Right.
Or there's I'll just make the servers tip them out more and then the kitchen's getting paid better and I don't have to worry about it, which is nonsense.
Right.
And even as somebody who fully supports the kitchen getting paid more, I don't think it should come out of the pockets of the servers.
I had, and this has happened several times where I'd have a table, hey, this food is great, this is cooked perfectly, hey, here's $20, give this to the cook. And I'm like, got it. As soon as it slowed down, I'd walk downstairs, hey, table 17, love their fish, said it was perfect, this is yours.
Well, yeah. I will also say, in my experience in banquets, we have a dedicated dishwasher who most of the banquet events, we get Jaime, and Jaime's great. Jaime's the best. And we got into a very regular habit of at the end of a banquet event where there's a bar and there's cash tips involved, because in banquets, it's always a pull tip, at least where I work. So the bartenders, the servers, they're making the same.
Yeah.
So when we're making our piles, then kind of make sure at least a five from everyone else goes into Jaime's pile, or whatever ones don't divide evenly, those go to Jaime. So, all right, maybe it's 14, $20 in his pocket at the end of the night. It's still a direct thank you for your work. It's optional. It came because we chose to thank him for that work. And I think that's entirely appropriate. If we had to change the gratuity payout to always include the dishwasher, well, there's this other guy that does a hack job and complains about it all the time, and he's getting paid by the house. Not great, I do admit, but he is getting, you know, an hourly rate that is more than my server's base pay. So is it worth it to, you know, I don't know. But it's also hard to, on a case-by-case basis, say this is how we're going to do it, because you know, then people say one thing or another's unfair. But all right, this is really interesting. We are going to continue the conversation, but we need to hit another break right here. Leave us a comment. Please hit like and subscribe if you like what we're doing. Share it with your friends. We will be right back.